day after day and year after year, concrete pavements are continually put to the test on American highways. Whether it's a mild, dry environment or a wet, freeze-thaw environment exposed to chemical de-icers, the concrete mix should be designed to resist environmental impacts and ensure durability of concrete pavements. Materials-related distresses can compromise concrete durability. The mechanisms that cause materials-related distresses can be physical or chemical. The most common materials-related distress mechanisms that affect pavements include freeze-thaw deterioration of the hydrated cement paste or the aggregate, deicer scaling of the concrete surface, alkali-silica reactivity, sulfate attack, and chemical deicer attack. Regardless of the mechanism, climate conditions, especially moisture, have considerable impact on the initiation and progression of materials-related distresses. Mitigation strategies to improve durability include properly selecting cementitious components and aggregate, reducing the permeability of concrete, and reducing the susceptibility of the hardened concrete to chemical attack. Concrete can exhibit cracking due to deterioration of the hydrated cement paste from repeated freeze-thaw cycles in a saturated state. Such cracking generally initiates near joints or other cracks where more moisture is available. Freeze-thaw durability of concrete is closely linked to the size and volume of air bubbles entrained in the concrete. Air is entrained in concrete by adding air-entraining admixtures during concrete mixing to create the air bubbles in the fresh concrete, which then remain once the concrete has hardened. The American Concrete Institute, ACI 31814, recommends concrete air content based on nominal maximum aggregate size and exposure to freeze-thaw conditions, as measured on freshly mixed concrete using AASHTO T152. Researchers now recognize that the spacing or distribution of the air bubbles is also crucial for freeze-thaw performance. The air void system of the fresh concrete can be characterized using the super air meter test.
And it gives us an indication of the actual air void system that's in the concrete, not just the total amount of air, which is a much better indicator of the future durability of the concrete.
Freeze-thaw durability of the paste can also be improved by reducing the maximum water to cementitious materials ratio of the concrete mix to below 0.45, as it is a key factor contributing to the porosity and permeability of the hardened concrete paste. Certain coarse aggregates can fracture or dilate excessively when exposed to repeated freezing and thawing in a saturated state, resulting in cracking of the mortar and deterioration of the concrete. Such cracking is typically observed parallel to joints and cracks where more moisture is available. Freeze-thaw deterioration of aggregate can be controlled by rejecting aggregate sources that do not pass AASHTO T161 screening test. It can also be mitigated by crushing susceptible aggregates to a size where they are no longer susceptible. Typical acceptance threshold values include a durability factor greater than 60 to 80% and length change less than 0.035% at 300 to 350 freeze-thaw cycles. Application of chemical deicers can lead to surface scaling by amplifying the freeze-thaw deterioration at the surface of the concrete. In addition to providing sufficient, well-distributed air bubbles and lower water to cementitious materials ratio to control scaling, the supplementary cementitious materials, or SCM content, should be limited to a maximum of 25% fly ash or 50% slag cement for hand-finished concrete. For maximum resistance to deicer scaling, concrete surface finishing activities must be kept to a minimum and good curing practices must be followed. Agencies should also consider providing a minimum 30-day drying period after curing and before allowing the use of deicers. Some agencies require a silane sealer on flatwork concrete at the end of construction, with the intent of providing additional protection for the concrete through its first winter. Alkali-silica reactivity, also known as ASR, occurs because of a reaction between alkalis in the hardened concrete pour solution and reactive silica in the aggregate, resulting in the formation of an expansive gel that fractures aggregate particles and surrounding paste. ASR is exhibited in the form of pattern cracking at joints and eventually over the entire slab surface. The ASR gel often exudes from the cracks and can be visible on the concrete surface. AASHTO R80 provides comprehensive recommendations for mitigating ASR for highway applications. There are generally four strategies to mitigate ASR. Avoid using reactive aggregate if non-reactive aggregates are locally available. Aggregate reactivity for ASR susceptibility can be evaluated through a testing regime that includes petrographic examination using ASTM C295, expansion testing of mortar bars using AASHTO T303, and expansion testing of concrete prisms using ASTM C1293. Reduce the total alkali in the concrete mixture to below a maximum alkali limit of 3 pounds per cubic yard sodium oxide equivalent per AASHTO PP65 protocol for a high level of prevention. Use SCMs such as fly ash, silica fume, slag cement, and metakaolin. Use lithium-based admixtures, particularly lithium nitrate, in fresh concrete at the time of batching. Sulfate from external or internal sources can react with aluminate phases in the hardened concrete paste, resulting in the formation of ettringite. The associated expansion causes fine cracking near joints and edges, or map cracking over the entire surface area. Sulfate attack is a concern for concrete placed in contact with soil in many areas of the western U.S. If the soil is tested and the sulfate exposure class is S1 through S3, mitigation is required. Mitigation strategies focus on reducing concrete permeability with increasing level of exposure. This is achieved through decreasing water to cementitious materials ratio, using acceptable SCMs, and using cementitious systems that are resistant to sulfate attack. Examples include AASHTO M85 Type 2 or 5 Portland cement, AASHTO M295 moderate or high sulfate resistance blended cements with the addition of pozzolanic SCMs, or slag cement. Chemical deicer attack is of concern for pavements located in areas with common use of sodium chloride, calcium chloride, and magnesium chloride for winter maintenance. Over the last decade, many concrete pavements in the U.S. have begun to show excessive damage at the joints due to chemical deicer attack. Calcium hydroxide in hardened concrete paste reacts with these chemicals to form the expansive phase calcium oxychloride. Chemical deicer attack can be mitigated by using cementitious systems that produce relative low levels of calcium hydroxide. This is most often accomplished through the use of a low calcium pozzolanic SCM, such as Class F fly ash, slag cement, or silica fume. Penetrating breathable sealant such as silane or siloxane applied directly to concrete joints have also shown to act as a barrier and provide some level of protection from these chemicals. Taking mitigation steps to reduce the amount of materials-related distress on concrete helps ensure durability of concrete and allows it to reach its full potential. For more information on ensuring durability of concrete, visit our website at fhwa.dot.gov/pavement or follow FHWA on social media.